sergeant with the sheriff's office.
Okay, and you'll be at that time right over there.
That's awesome. That whole table here, we can spread out.
I'm gonna go find a couple of ice.
There is the ice downstairs, there's an ice machine.
Okay.
Yeah, you wanna, that'll get you in.
Oh, will it?
Yeah, get you down the stairs.
Get you down there.
There it is, right in the kitchen, there's a big ice machine.
How are you?
Good.
Alyssa, right?
Yeah.
Did you see Mr. Perry anywhere?
I did not. Yes, you're on the record.
We'll call the meeting of the Civil Service Board to order. It is August the 8th, 9:30 a.m. in one of the classrooms of the Public Safety Building. Board present, board member Mr. Tim Perry, Vice Chairman Dr. A.Y. Howell, Chairman Terry Smith, our clerk, Ms. Charity Clark, our hearing officer, Mr. Rich Snell. Gentlemen, have you had a chance to look at the agenda?
Yes, sir.
I hear a motion to approve.
Make a motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
So moving second to approve the agenda. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Motion carries unanimously. Gentlemen, have you had a chance to read the minutes?
Yes, sir. I motion we approve the minutes as presented.
Second motion.
Motion and second to approve the minutes of our last meeting. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous. Go through the items for consideration and discussion. Number one, hearing officer, you want to handle that?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I had no report on the writ of cert concerning Mr. Huge. Apparently, it's still pending in the Forsyth County Superior Court. As far as item two, I indicated previously that the judge had orally announced that he would be granting the Civil Service Board's motion to dismiss, and I presented a proposed order to the judge, as did Forsyth County, and the judge has not signed either of those orders yet. So he did indicate he had a pretty busy travel schedule, so that may be what's holding it up, but I don't have an order at this time.
So we need to leave that item on our agenda until he signs it?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Item number three, update on the civil service policy, I think Ms. Clark has.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of civil service policy changes have been made by the Board of Commissioners since your last meeting. One of those is just an update to a resolution, an update to civil service handbook, policy 5, section 8D, which regards subpoenas. And basically, the only change was updating the language to be in compliance with the Georgia State Code. They had made some changes in the legislation that went into effect in January, so we were just updating that to be consistent with the statute. So I have four copies, one copy for each of you that can go in your handbook just to replace the old copy. You have one for you, sir? And then the other change, and I'll let the hearing officer present this one, but he did present to the Board of Commissioners in regards to the Policy 5, Section 8A regarding representation. So if he wants to speak to that change. I don't have a signed copy, but I do have a copy of what the board did adopt at their meeting.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, the Board of Commissioners held its hearing on August the 1st, I believe, and a proposed resolution had been presented by the county attorney to the Board of Commissioners. On behalf of this board, I presented an alternative resolution, and based on discussion at the meeting by the Board of Commissioners, the Board of Commissioners elected to accept our version of the rule change. So the rule change would read as follows. The appellant may request the assistance of an attorney of his or her own choosing in preparing and presenting the appeal to the Civil Service Board. The county attorney will represent a county actor in preparing and presenting the appeal to the Civil Service Board, provided that a constitutional officer as defined at Georgia Constitution Article 9, Section 1, Paragraph 3A shall have discretion to utilize the county attorney or other retained counsel at a civil service hearing. Notwithstanding anything contained herein, either the appellant or the county actor may elect to not be represented by an attorney at the civil service hearing. So what the board was trying to do, our board, was as it appeared that the Board of Commissioners was going to change the rule, we made it so that if there was a county employee, for example, who was employed by the tax assessor's office or by a non-constitutional officer, then they would be treated the same way as an employee who's appealing from the sheriff's department or from the position of a constitutional officer.
Which is fine. Did a good job. I appreciate that. That does that go into our handbook?
It will once it's signed. It's not been accepted or signed by the board yet.
Okay. Gentlemen, is there anything else that needs to come before the board that y'all know of?
No, sir.
Well, at this time, I'm going to, and we're a little bit early, but we'll give people a chance to get in here, but at this time, I'm going to turn the meeting over to our hearing officer, Mr. Rich Neville, and we'll take like a 5-minute recess, and when we come back, and you'll take over from there.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Everything. We're in recess for 5 minutes.
Okay.
Okay, we ready to get started? Do you mind closing the door?
Yes, you're on the record.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Witnesses, this is mainly just going to be for the parties. I'm going to go over the hearing procedure, so you can just kind of stand at ease for a little bit. Today is August the 8th, 2013. This is the hearing concerning Walter Skowronski, who is appealing his termination from the Forsyth County Sheriff's Department. The hearing is being tape recorded pursuant to the rules of the Civil Service Board. Mrs. Clerk is our clerk. She will be tape recording the hearing. We'd like to ask everyone, if they could, to put your cell phones on silent during the hearing if you haven't already done so. If you're testifying, make sure you do that before you begin the testimony. I'm going to go around the room and ask the individuals who are participating in the hearing, not the witnesses, but just the individuals who are participating in the hearing, to identify themselves. Before I do that, however, I'd like to ask Mr. Hansford to recognize that he is here, and if you have anything, any comments you'd like to add, Mr. Hansford, based on my letter that I've written to you earlier.
Thank you, Mr. Neville. Nothing really to add. We're not going to put any objections on the record in light of the amendment that the Board of Commissioners made to the Civil Service Ordinance regarding representation. We recognize and appreciate that amendment. Thank them for recognizing the constitutional officer's ability to use counsel as he chooses, and we just make the board aware that after this hearing, the sheriff will likely choose to proceed with counsel at these types of hearings. But for this one, he is waiving that, and we are not placing any objections on the record.
All right, thank you. And just to reiterate, the board at its last meeting determined that the intent of the rule that was that it. The appellant, Mr. Skowronski, was not going to have counsel represent him at the hearing, that the county actor would not either. And so that's how we will proceed today at this hearing. I'll begin first and go around the room and just identify myself for the record. I'm Richard Neville. I'm the hearing officer for the Forsyth County Civil Service Board.
I'm Charity Clark. I'm the clerk to the Civil Service Board.
Terry Smith. I'm the chairman of the Civil Service Board.
I'm Avery Howell, vice chairman of the board.
I'm Tim Perry. I'm a member of the Civil Service Board.
Sergeant Gregg Boyer with the Sheriff's Office Internal Affairs Unit.
Walter Skowronski.
All right. I'm going to go over the hearing procedure. I'm not sure you've ever done this before. I'm not sure, Lieutenant or Sergeant, if you've ever done this before either. Well, what we'll do is start with opening statements. The county will begin with its opening statement, followed by Mr. Skowronski. In an opening statement, what you tend to do is it's not evidence. You're just telling the board what you expect to prove, what you expect your case will be about, what you expect the evidence is going to be. After opening statement, the county will begin with its case and will call its first witness. After that witness is called and you do direct examination, you'll have an opportunity to do cross-examination. You can ask that witness anything that you want to. It's not limited to what was asked in direct. If the county wants to then redirect the witness, you can do so. If you want to recross the witness, you can do so. But the only limitation on that is you have to stick to what was covered in redirect. Can't go into new material. It's only limited what was covered in the direct. After the county calls all of its witnesses, then you will have an opportunity to present your witnesses, Mr. Skowronski. And the same procedure applies. The county would then have an opportunity to cross-examine your witnesses. As far as exhibits or documents, if you want to introduce a document into evidence, you'll need to mark that exhibit. What what the board tends to do in the past is for the appellant, just use your initials WS1 and then, you know, WS2, so on and so forth for any exhibits you have. For the county, just use FC1, FC2. If you've already marked them, then you don't have to remark them, just use what you've done before. If you want to show a document to the board, You can do that. We have no objections to that, but you have to have the document admitted into evidence first. So don't just walk up and start waving documents up. They need to be admitted. If you have an objection, we'll deal with that before it's admitted. But once it's admitted, you can publish it. That's what lawyers call, or show it to the board. Okay. The next thing is, once the document is admitted into evidence, Mrs. Clark will maintain those documents after the hearing. If you want to use the document during closing argument or during the hearing, you're free to do that. But just make sure that if you enter something into evidence, you don't walk out with it mistakenly. That lawyers even do that. So just make sure if it's admitted that it stays up here. After the county presents its case, after both sides present their case, you would be entitled to what's called rebuttal. So if the county wants to present rebuttal evidence to rebut what Mr. Skowronski has put forth in his case, you can do that. But it needs to be limited to rebutting what he's done, not just reintroducing what you've already stated in your opening case. Okay. After all the evidence is presented, I'll ask both sides if that's all they have to present, and if so, then we'll close the record in the case. The next thing that will be done will be closing arguments. Each side will be entitled to make a closing argument. After you make closing arguments, then the board will consider the matter and issue a written decision within 30 days. As far as breaks, we'll have to break just before lunch today. We'll come back after lunch, and we'll have to, if we hadn't finished up by 4:15 today, we'll have to recess and follow up another day. But those are kind of the rules. If we need to take a break, we will, just periodically as needed. I believe that's all I can think of, Mr. Chairman. If there's anything, members of the board, that I haven't covered.
You just may want to let them know that the board is also happy to ask questions.
After the witnesses testified, the board would be entitled to ask questions. Anything else?
You might want to mention that excuse the witnesses will be out of the room. If you want to mention that, then being on the call.
Yeah, either side would have the right of what we call sequestration, which means that if either party wants the witnesses to not be present, so that we call them in one at a time, you can elect to have that. Do you wish to elect to have the witnesses? All right, so we'll invoke the rule of sequestration, and what that means, witnesses, is that as you testify, you are not allowed to, when you walk out of here after your testimony is completed, to discuss your testimony with someone who hasn't testified. So you can't go out and say, well, here's what they asked me, or here's what I said, that sort of thing. So once you testify, you are prohibited from discussing your testimony. You can remain during opening statements if you wish to do so. But once the evidence starts, you'll need to step out. Now, if y'all want to place some of your witnesses on call, we can work with you on that. I'm not sure what arrangements you make. If you need some this morning, you don't think you'll need them until this afternoon, then you can release them, but just make sure that if we'd like to keep this going, if we can finish today, we'd like to finish today. So we don't want to be in a situation where we don't have a witness who's available. Okay, Mr. Skowronski, anything else? You ready to begin? Mr. Boyer, you ready to begin?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right, I will ask Sergeant Boyer, you can begin with your opening statement.
But y'all don't have to stay now. If you want to leave, you can.
I was going to say, do you have an idea of your order of witnesses?
I do. All of our witnesses will be this morning. We're We'd like them to remain as they will go fairly quickly and take care of that this morning.
So if you were subpoenaed by the county, then you can remain in the classroom where you were before. If you've been subpoenaed by Mr. Skowronski, you have been with the meeting this afternoon or be on call.
Do you think you're gonna take until lunch?
Yes, sir. I would think so.
Yeah, that's fine, Mr. Skowronski. If you want to have your witnesses, just report back. 1:15.
Yeah, and if I could just, before you leave, if you will put your name and a number you can be reached at, and leave it in that room in case we need to call you back before, then I can get in touch with you. Yes, whatever number you can be reached at. If you want to take it into the other room, if you guys want to go ahead.
Y'all want to say you have to say that.
Skowronski was hired in February of 2008, and he was terminated on April 26th of 2013. When he worked here at the Sheriff's Office, he was a deputy first class. He was assigned to patrol, to perform patrol duties, which involve answering 911 calls and checking businesses and subdivisions and patrolling the public. While he was here, he received several commendations. In 2008, he received a commendation for conducting CPR on an unconscious individual. He was nominated for Deputy of the Month in March of 2009. In May of 2009, he was recognized for calling in and responding off-duty to a hostage situation. And he was here for 5 years and received his five-year service ribbon also in 2013. While he was here, he also had several disciplinary actions. In 2011, for AWOL, and we'll discuss these in more detail with witnesses. In August of 2011, a violation of professional image, where he received a written counseling. In January of 2012, conduct unbecoming on and off duty, in which he received a written counseling. In July of 2012, an 8-hour suspension for a second violation of professional image. March of 2013, an 8-hour suspension for recovered property and evidentiary material violation of the policy. And then the violation that resulted in his termination was in this year, in March of 2013, and it was duty to read, understand, and comply with orders, 2 counts of violation of law, conduct unbecoming on and off duty. And for that, he was terminated. We will call witnesses today that will testify to the facts that while Deputy Skowronski was a deputy here at the Sheriff's Office, that although he did receive some commendations and he did do his job and perform his duties, he also had a pattern of problems in the agency where he received discipline and where policies were violated and things of that. And due to the fact that this pattern continued and then that the last violation of policy was a pretty serious violation, the recommendation was made to terminate him, and that was authorized all the way up to the sheriff, who ultimately decided that termination was the correct action for consequence for his actions. Thank you.
Basically, I did do some policy violations. There are admitted freely to any mistake I made with the Sheriff's Department. I've admitted to it. I haven't lied about anything. I do not agree with the finding that they say that I attempted to plead a theft. That was no intention there. I don't agree with it personally. And by the letter of the law, it doesn't fit. Most of my infractions have been caused by language. I've been military, worked offshore, law enforcement, most of my adult life, 20 years. I tend to curse. It happens. Those are where most of my infractions came from. Nothing for dishonesty, nothing for lying, nothing for cheating, for stealing. My infractions were verbal. So, I think those are minor infractions, personally. I have a few. Other than that, I don't think the termination was, I think it was overkill. I don't think I deserve termination. I've been a good cop. I do my job. I do it well. And I haven't worked with anybody that I know of that wouldn't want me standing next to them if something happened. And that's it.
Thanks, sir. All right. Looks like a lawyer. Sergeant Boyd, would you like to call your first witness?
Sir, I would like to tender an exhibit. Could I do that prior to calling the first witness?
Sure.
I'd like to tender Exhibit 1, which is a copy of the policies that Mr. Skowronski violated when he was with the Sheriff's Office. Sir, I'll be testifying as the first witness.
Okay. Do you swear the testimony you're about to give in the matter before the board will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth shall be done?
Yes, sir.
You would please state your full name and your rank.
Gregg Travis Boyer, Sergeant in the Internal Affairs Unit of the Sheriff's Office. Okay. Exhibit 1 that I just tendered to the board is the policy violations that Mr. Skowronski violated when he was working for the Sheriff's Office. I'd like to just very briefly review what those were for professional image.
Okay, let me stop here. And these are the Forsyth County Sheriff's Office policies that are in place at this time.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mr. Skowronski, do you have any objections?
No.
Okay. It won't be admitted without objection.
For professional image, failure to work diligently or with a bearing consistent with the image of professional law enforcement, which includes using obscene language,
failure to furnish information for law enforcement service, lack of courtesy, neglect of duty, no failure to give suitable attention to the performance of duty, unnecessary absence from one's assignment during a tour of duty, failure to perform duties or comply with rules or regulations or policies and procedures, absent without leave, when an employee fails to report to work or approve training and has failed to notify their supervisor 30 minutes prior to that assignment, duty to read, understand, and comply with orders, failure to read, understand, comply, or maintain a working knowledge of laws, rules, regulations, special orders, policies, verbal orders, recovered property, evidentiary material, failure to turn over designated to the designated agent of the agency or properly handle evidence that stolen, lost, recovered. All material shall be turned over prior to the completion of the tour of duty unless otherwise instructed by competent authority. And violation of law, violation or attempted violation of any federal, state, or county law is prohibited, whether criminal proceedings are instituted or not. Conduct unbecoming, on or off duty, conduct which adversely affects the morale or efficiency of the agency, which has a tendency to destroy public respect for the employee and or the agency and destroy confidence in the operation of the county service. Just for one of the discipline issues that we're going to discuss, the definition of an extension of law enforcement service, which are considered part-time jobs. There are two types, secondary employment and extension of law enforcement service. The extension of law enforcement service, extra duty job, is performed by a deputy for public and private enterprise. It's things that are appropriate for on-duty deputies, but the sheriff's office is unable to provide them due to manpower and diverting primary personnel and things like that. These may include additional security. Deputies that are working on these extension of law enforcement services per the policy are subject to all rules, regulations, policies, and procedures currently in effect by the sheriff's office and are subject to disciplinary action for infractions of these rules, regulations, and policies. Deputies are also responsible for notifying the 911 center of the location of the detail and wear the same official agency uniform unless there's special authorization for that. That's Exhibit 1, the policies that we're going to discuss that Mr. Skowronski violated. Exhibit 2 is the schedule of penalties. The...
Let me stop right here. Is this also a current policy in the Sheriff's Department?
Yes, sir.
And was it in effect at the time of Mr. Skowronski's termination?
Yes, sir.
As well as his employment?
Yes, sir.
Any objection to Exhibit 2?
No, sir.
Okay, without objection.
The schedule of penalties are the recommended punishments for the violations that we just discussed, and for all of the violations. Just a few things that are written in there that are pertinent to this hearing, I believe. This is a guideline. It exists. Policy may exist that could possibly warrant a less severe or more severe type of corrective action than is recommended in the penalties. If the employee is charged with more than one violation resulting from the same act or conduct, the investigating deputy or supervisor may consider each violation separately, may also consider previous misconduct incidents in determining that corrective action. We may also consider any mitigating circumstances that warrant a more severe or less severe corrective action. For professional image from first offense to fourth offense is from written counseling all the way to demotion or dismissal. For neglect of duty, it's 8-hour suspension to the fourth offense, demotion or dismissal. Absent without leave from written counseling to the fifth offense is demotion or dismissal. Duty to read, understand, and comply with orders from written counseling to demotion or dismissal. Recovered property, first offense to third offense is just 8 hours of suspension through demotion or dismissal. Violation of law, first offense is 40-hour suspension, and third offense recommended is demotion to dismissal. And conduct unbecoming, the first offense is written counseling to the fourth offense recommendation is demotion to dismissal. it okay if I get a fine?
Sure.
Did you want to publish those to the
board? Yes, I would. Exhibit 3. Of the recommendation for termination by Captain Hoffman in the last policy violation that there was investigated. It's also a copy of Mr. Skowronski's statement, a copy of the disciplinary action report itself, a copy of the informal appeal that Mr. Skowronski filed, and a copy of the response from the sheriff in that informal. Violation that resulted in Mr. Skowronski's termination was brought to the attention of the Internal Affairs Unit through a citizen complaint. As the supervisor of the Internal Affairs Unit, I received this information and assigned it to my unit to investigate. The information that we received from the avenues was that Mr. Skowronski had turned in a timesheet for 4 hours for March the 15th, and that the security personnel at the avenue did not observe any deputy present during that time. And so they brought that to the attention of the sheriff's office to Captain Hoffman, who assigned it to Sergeant Weeks to look into, and then it was turned over to Internal Affairs by Chief Giordano. In our investigation, we talked to Mr. Durden, Mr. Turnbull, and several people at the avenues and verified that information was accurate and correct. And then we conducted interviews of personnel in the Sheriff's Office, including Sergeant Weeks, including Mr. Skowronski, and some of the other individuals that were involved. During that investigation, we determined that there were several violations of policy that Mr. Skowronski had violated by his conduct. The first of which was conduct unbecoming off-duty, on and off-duty conduct, which I've described in the previous exhibits. Mr. Skowronski admitted that while he was at the Avenue for approximately 45 minutes of the 4 hours that he was assigned to be there that night, that his assigned duties included patrolling the parking lots and the buildings and for physical security. He admitted that during that 45 minutes that he said he was there, that he was working in his car on sheriff's office reports and where nobody that we could find had observed him or seen. But he admitted that he was there working on that sheriff's office business during the 45 minutes that he was there. We found him in violation of neglect of duty. Mr. Skowronski admitted that he did not call out on the radio that he was at the part-time job, which is required by policy that we just also reviewed. He also admitted that he didn't get anybody to cover the job, that he was late getting to the job because of the sheriff's office duties, and that he didn't find somebody to cover the job for it since he wasn't going to be able to get there on time, which is also a violation of the policy. Duty to read, understand, and comply with orders for secondary employment. Mr. Skowronski had worked the Avenue job for quite a while, I believe it was almost a year. And there is there's a sign-up sheet at the precinct with a memo, and you have to fill out here when you're going to work and things like that. He admitted that he had not read the memo about the job, that he did not comply with the memorandum sign-up sheet requirement that said that when you went to the job that you should check in at the security office. We also found Mr. Skowronski in violation of law, criminal attempt to commit theft, and false statements and writings. Mr. Skowronski admitted that he turned in the timesheet at the part-time job on March the 20th for the date of March the 15th that he said he worked, that he didn't work the complete 4 hours, and that he would have received $140 if the matter had not been brought to the attention of the Avenue by security staff. He admitted that if they had sent him a check, that he would have accepted the money. And so, for those reasons, we found in violation of law also. Based on the investigation that Internal Affairs conducted, the Internal Affairs Unit handles administrative investigations in the Sheriff's Office only. We do not handle criminal investigations. Our role is to investigate violations of policy, and that's what we did in this case. If the sheriff felt it was, if he would like to pursue anything criminal, that would be turned over to the criminal investigators and not a function of our unit. And so at the conclusion of the administrative investigation, we turn those findings over to the chief, and then he reviews those with the sheriff, and then the supervisor of the deputy or the employee involved will then review that and makes the recommendation for punishment. The Internal Affairs Unit makes no recommendations for punishment. We're strictly a fact-finding unit. The recommendation for punishment that I tender to you in Exhibit 3 is from Captain Mark Hoffman, which we will hear from later. And that recommendation was due to this pattern of decisions, due to the numerous violations, as we stated in the schedule of penalties, that the cumulative violations can affect what the recommended penalty is. And due to the accumulation of these violations, Captain Hoffman recommended termination. On the disciplinary action recommendation, where that was recommended, you'll see that was concurred with from Captain Hoffman. This is on page 4, I believe. Page 4. Captain Hoffman made the recommendation. Major Taylor concurred with that termination. Chief Deputy Mike Giordano
concurred with that recommendation, and Sheriff Dwayne Piper concurred with that recommendation. As a result of the sheriff agreeing with that termination, a pre-dismissal conference was held with Mr. Skowronski by Ms. Pat Carson at the South Precinct, and where she discussed the reasons for termination there. After that pre-dismissal conference, there was a termination meeting held with Carlene Chalker, Mr. Skowronski, and myself. The reasons for his termination were discussed there, the rights that he had for informal appeal, the information that he was given by Ms. Chalker to his rights as a terminated employee. The next page in that exhibit, Mr. Skowronski did file an informal appeal with the sheriff. You have a copy of that. And the response from the sheriff, after his review of that appeal, he decided that the termination was the appropriate action for those violations and upheld that. The process that the sheriff's office followed for investigating, for recommending appropriate punishment, for pre-dismissal conference, termination meeting, all of those procedures were followed as outlined in the civil service manual, in the county policy, as well as in the sheriff's office policy. That's all I have.
Mr. Skowronski, would you like to cross-examine Sergeant Porter?
Yes.
During the interview, were you present for any of that?
No, sir.
To your knowledge, I haven't reviewed all the interviews. Was I ever asked if I would return the money that the mistake been brought to my attention after I received payment?
I don't believe you were asked that directly.
All right. Would you like to call your next witness?
Yes. Okay. We'd like to call Mr. Cordero Durden.
Is that D-U-R?
D-U-R-D-E-N? Yes.
And he is with
previously the Avenue, now the Collection Security. Explaining to the board what your involvement was in March with Mr. Skowronski and his off-duty employment at the Avenue.
My weekend guys informed me that we did not have a deputy for Friday night. So I informed property management that Monday that we did not have any deputy. Joe Turnbull, which is the property manager, told me to get in contact with the captain. So when I called the captain and left him a message, he called me back and said he was going to look at it.
And after you spoke with Captain Hoffman, did you meet with or see Mr. Skowronski after that in relation to this incident?
Yes. I can't recall what day it was, but he did come to the management office expressing that we should have contacted him instead of going to Captain Hoffman. And property management was just telling him we just did the proper thing was to contact our whoever we contacted in Forsyth County. So that would lead to us calling Captain Hoffman.
And the date that Deputy Skowronski was supposed to work was on March the 15th. I know you didn't recall the date. That was on March the 15th. On March the 20th is the date that he came into the office and spoke with you. And who else was there?
Property manager Joseph Turnbull.
And what did Deputy Skowronski say to you when he came in?
He was going on about, he didn't show up till about 10 or 10:30, and he may have stayed 30 minutes. He couldn't recall what exactly time he showed up, and he was in the far south part of the property near the fields and the most deserted place that he could be filling out paperwork.
And is that what he's supposed to be doing when the Avenue was paying him for his part-time job?
No, he's supposed to contact the security at 7 o'clock when he arrived or whenever he arrived and let us know that we did have off-duty deputies so we could notate it in our daily reports, but he didn't.
So is it your conclusion that on March the 15th that Deputy Skowronski did not perform the assignments that he's supposed to when he's working at the part-time job at the Avenue?
Yes.
Did he turn in a timesheet for March the 15th for that month?
Yes, he did. I can't recall what date he turned in, but he turned in a timesheet that said he was there from 7 to 11.
But you just testified too that he told you that he had only been there maybe 30 minutes?
Yes, sir.
On that evening, and that he had sat in a far corner and worked on other things, not the assigned duties at that part-time job?
Yes, sir.
Do you know what caused Mr. Skowronski to come to your office and discuss the timesheet with you and Mr. Turnbull?
I do not.
Did he say anything about what had happened prior to him coming over there to talk to you guys?
I can't recall.
And we said earlier that was 5 days after the incident, and this was after your conversation with Captain Hoffman about Mr. Skowronski turning in the timesheet, and yet your security people not seeing anybody there.
Time periods I can't recall, but it sounds right.
Do you believe that Mr. Skowronski came to your office to correct it because he had been caught?
Yes.
I have no further questions.
Cross the panel.
Mr. Dirk.
Yes. How many security guys were working that night?
Give or take two or three.
Give or take two or three. During our conversation, do you recall saying to me that there was only one person working that night, but you were shorthanded?
I can't recall, but it could have been.
During the conversation, did Mr. Turnbull give me back the timesheet and tell me that I could fill out another one?
Yes.
During the past year that I have worked at the Avenues, have there ever been any other complaints against me?
No.
The original sheet that I turned in, did you look at it?
I looked at it, just had
Did you notice if there were times on it?
I can't recall.
When speaking with you and Mr. Turnbull, prior to me leaving, did Mr. Turnbull seem that he was satisfied with what I explained to him and what corrective action I was going to take for any future incidents?
He did.
That's all I have.
Any redirect?
No.
Does any member of the board have any questions of this witness?
Mr. Perry?
Just have one question.
Yes, sir.
How much time had passed from the time he turned in his timesheet until he came back and asked for the timesheet back to correct?
I cannot recall. That was during the transition of the new owners and everything, so it was...
Do you have an idea? Was it a day or so? Was it a week? Was it 2 weeks?
I don't believe it was a whole week. But somewhere in between that week time period. But I cannot recall any dates.
Got a question.
How much trainer information do you tell these folks that are working for you right off the union? How much information are they told on their duties and responsibilities? So, from what I gather, you didn't have a formal notice book or anything to tell these folks exactly what their duties were, what times would be there, and they have all the decisions and so on. How much training do you give these folks? You just tell them to come in and work? I mean, what do you tell them?
We had contacted the former captain, I can't remember his name, I think Freeman. And Joe Turnbull told him as soon as they come on the property to call the security cell phone. And once they do that, I meet up with that person and tell them, hey, this is what I want you to do from this time to this time. But in this case, nothing.
Thank you.
In every instance before in the past year that Mr. Skowronski called when he got to the avenues and you met with him and you told him what to do?
I believe so. When I worked the evenings, I'm pretty sure that I talked with him because I made it my point of duty to find out who's the deputy.
So there was really no question that he knew that he was supposed to call?
Yes.
And I think what Dr. Howell was asking was, when a first-time officer comes in for off-duty work, is there a manual? Is there anything written down that's presented to him to tell him what he's supposed to do?
There's nothing written down. Everything is verbal.
Okay. I'm confused about the time periods. The 15th is when this incident happened. You said it was a Friday night that he didn't show
yes.
up or you didn't see.
Well, I didn't see it. My officer.
Your officers told you that he didn't show
yes.
up. And then on the 20th, I believe is what Sergeant Boyer said. Was that when he came in?
I cannot recall.
Well, he did come in at some point in time after
yes.
the 15th.
Yes.
Had he already turned his time card in before he came in and talked with you?
Yes.
He had. Is that the same meeting when he asked for his time card back?
No.
So you had another meeting with him after that? He
yes.
came back? That's when he asked for his time card back.
Yes.
Do you know if he had turned his time card in before the 20th, before he met with you?
He didn't meet with me. He just turned in his time sheet.
I know. When did he turn? What days? What's the schedule of turning in their time sheet?
Whenever they feel like it. They don't get paid until like 2 weeks after that.
Do they turn it in after each work session?
Some officers do, some of them don't. They turn it in like a week later.
Do you know what Mr. Skowronski did?
No.
So he came the 15th is when this happened. On the 20th is when he came in and confronted you and said you should have talked to him instead of Captain Hoffman. Is that that conversation? The 15th was a Friday night. The 20th would have been a Wednesday.
I'm not quite sure. I know he turned in a timesheet and we didn't talk to him after that, but once it came to proper attention that I told him, hey, we didn't have a deputy, that's when it, that's when I called Captain Hall.
So you're not sure if the 20th was when he came in and told you that you should have talked to him instead of Captain Hall?
Yeah.
But he did talk with you about that, and then he came in again and met with you and Mr.
No, everything happened that that final when he came and picked up the timesheet, when he told everybody, well, told me in property management that we should have talked to him and not have gone to Captain Hoffman.
And that's when he asked for his timesheet back?
Yes.
I don't have any other questions.
No. Support you. We allow questions.
Now, so we usually approve it, but there have been exceptions. No, after what the board asked questions, there's no further questions asked.
You can call him as a party in the case.
Like calling him back to the board.
As part of your case, you can call him as a witness.
Okay. I'll give this to Ms. Hansford.
Yes, sir. If you need anything, like dates, specifics, property manager Joe Turnbull would be the best candidate.
Are you calling him?
No, sir.
We'll see you.
All right, thank you. You may be excused right now. Do you have any matters?
No, I do not. But I would like to recall.
We have your phone number?
Yes.
Are you working today?
No.
How far do you live from here?
I stay in Buckhead, about 30 minutes.
Will it be this afternoon before we leave the contact?
Okay. Can you make yourself available for this afternoon?
I can try.
Do you have any objection, Sergeant Boyer, to just allowing Mr. Skowronski to follow up questions? You may follow up on with any questions as well based on the board's questions.
I have no objection.
All right. Let me ask you to go first. Do you have any additional questions of this witness?
Yes, sir. The reason that you contacted the sheriff's office was because a timesheet had been turned in by a deputy, and that whether there were one or several of your security officers there, they didn't see anybody working that night. Is that correct?
Correct.
Is that part of their job to patrol the avenue and to make contact with a deputy or see if someone's working?
Yes.
And that's something that they do every night, that there's a deputy assigned there, as far as you know?
As far as I know.
When Mr. Skowronski came back after he was supposed to work on the 15th is the date that he was supposed to work. When he came back in there, we know that was a Friday night on the 15th, so sometime after that, the following week or somewhere in there, when he came back, it was after you had brought it to the attention of the sheriff's office. And when he came back, he wanted to get that timesheet back that he had turned in. Is that correct?
That sounds correct.
And he did, in fact, take that timesheet?
Yes.
did he turn in another timesheet for the 30 minutes or 45 minutes that he said that he worked?
To my knowledge, he did, but I wasn't there to see him turn in anything.
So you don't know if he turned in a corrected timesheet or not?
I don't know.
Are you familiar with the information that the deputies are given to work your part-time job at the precinct?
The only thing I'm familiar with is they're supposed to call security.
They're supposed to call security. Are there, on the timesheet that your officers fill out, are they supposed to write on there the things that they do during that assigned time that they're at the attic?
The sheriff? Oh, deputy sheriffs?
Yes, sir. Are the deputy sheriffs?
They're supposed to write what they're doing and the times.
And what kind of things are they supposed to do that they write on the form?
Patrol the property, warn someone of speeding, or everything that they do on a daily basis, just helping us out a little bit more.
So they're supposed to account for their activity?
Yes.
Do you know if Deputy Skowronski accounted for his activity on the timesheet that he turned in?
The first one?
Yes, sir.
I didn't read it, but it was almost full. I did, when Section 8 fill out, it was already full of what he did.
And what did that make you think when you saw that it was full, but you had seen no one there that night, or your people had not seen anyone?
Someone's getting paid for 4 hours not doing nothing.
That's all I have.
On the timesheet at the bottom, you're familiar with the timesheet, right?
Not what it says on the bottom. I just pay attention to what she wrote in.
On the bottom of the timesheet, there's a line for us to put our phone number. And it states that if there are any problems, questions, or concerns, to call us at the number we write down. Wouldn't it make sense to you that if there's a problem, you would call that person?
Yes, but when the property management tell me to do something, I have to do it.
I understand that. So if you don't call the person and I find out about it later, would it not be expected? Most normal people would go to the place and say, hey, this is what happened. Trying to explain themselves, trying to correct the problem, make sure it doesn't happen again?
Yes.
Do you recall if I specifically asked for my timesheet back?
I can't recall it.
Or do you recall Mr. Turnbull giving it to me?
I can't recall.
That's all I
need. Does the board have any additional questions based on the additional testimony?
May this witness be excused. You may be excused. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Call your next witness.
Before we call the next witness, could we ask Sergeant Boyer? We didn't get a chance. The board didn't get a chance to question him.
That's right. Yeah.
Could we just ask a few questions?
Absolutely.
I don't know what the other board members do, but I do have one. So,
Mr. Beer, do you have any questions?
Yes, sir, I have a couple. Sergeant Boyer, do you know how much time had passed from the day he turned his timesheet in until he came back and asked for it back?
Yes, sir, it was 5 days. He came back on March the 20th.
Okay.
And he was supposed to work on March the 15th.
And that timesheet that was turned in, you said it was fully complete with activities of duties performed for each of those 4 hours?
Yes, sir. In the bottom third of the sheet, there are blank lines. And on those lines that the deputies are to fill out their activity that they conducted during that tour of duty. Mr. Skowronski had stated to us that he pre-filled those out. So the timesheet, almost every line on it had a written activity that were normal activities for that time that they worked at the avenue. On the left side of all those notations of activity, there was a blanks for the times that those would have been performed, if they were performed. On the timesheet that the other timesheet, because we don't have the timesheet that Mr. Skowronski turned in and got back from Mr. Turnbaugh, we don't have that. But on the other timesheet that he turned in for some other time that he worked, it was also all of that was filled in, but there were no times written on there. And then Mr. Skowronski told us that he just didn't put the times on there that night, that all of the other information was handwritten and copied and pre-filled out every time he turned in, and that he just wrote those times in as he did them. And on that timesheet, he told us that there were no times written on there, that he had not done that.
I'm not familiar with the timesheet or format. But I wonder, is there a place at the bottom of it for the employee to sign stating that the facts above are correct?
Yes, sir.
Who brought the timesheet to Mr. Skowronski's attention? Did he remember, or did someone approach him?
When Mr. Durden contacted Captain Hoffman contacted Mr. Skowronski's sergeant, Sergeant Weeks, and Sergeant Weeks talked to Mr. Skowronski about this complaint that had come in, and that there was a timesheet filled out and that they hadn't seen an officer, and he basically directed Mr. Skowronski to go find out what was going on and to sort that out with the avenue at that time.
Thank you.
Got any questions? You stated that you and I believe Ms. Carson and one other person was present at the pre-dismissal hearing?
At the pre-dismissal conference, it was just Ms. Carson and Mr. Skowronski.
Oh, just the two of them?
Yes, sir.
You weren't there?
No, sir.
You gonna call Ms. Carson as a witness?
No, sir.
Okay. So you don't know whether she gave him the opportunity to voice an appeal, and that's one of the purposes of the pre-dismissal hearing, is to give the employee a final say. You don't know whether that took place or not. You weren't there?
Not from hearing it. He signed paperwork that he understood that with Ms. Carson.
Okay.
And he also signed paperwork with Ms. Chalker at the termination hearing that he understood he had that opportunity.
Okay. I don't have any other questions.
Okay. Thank you. You may step down and call your next witness. You can call him as part of your case if you.
Who's your next witness?
Next witness is Captain Mark Hoffman.
For the board, your involvement in the investigation into Mr. Skowronski not working the time at the avenue on his part-time job.
Okay, just to give you the short version, I was contacted by their director of security that they had a timesheet with no
no one showing up. Best that their security could determine, no one had shown up. So I gave that information to Lieutenant Fisher, said please get the statement, see what happened, see if they showed up, if they showed up late, what happened. Lieutenant Fisher was going to go out of town. He got a statement and he faxed it to me, and the statement was basically a handwritten, incomplete statement. It didn't cover what I'd asked, you know, how, when you got there, sign on the radio. So I gave it to Sergeant Weeks to complete because Lieutenant Fisher was on vacation. Sergeant Weeks did, and as he completed that, he felt that he wasn't being told the whole truth. So we discussed it, and it was sent to Internal Affairs to finally get to the bottom of and look at the entire investigation. Memorandum to all the officers on the procedures for a off-duty security job.
And which off-duty security job is that memo related to?
It pertains to the avenues security, and it's dated March 20th of 2012.
And in that document, does it describe some of the things that the deputy is supposed to do on that job and how they're supposed to complete paperwork?
It does.
Would you tell the board what that says?
You want it admitted?
Yes, sir. I'd like to admit that.
Any objection? Admitted without objection.
Okay.
And what the FC? FC-9? Is that how you had it?
Yes, sir.
One of the things it says, you will fill out a W-9 form, mail it to daily, first time you work it for the job, or you won't be paid. Each night upon finishing the job, you fill out a daily timesheet. This will ensure you get paid for the day and let Cindy Mirabelli with the avenues know. What went under on the shift, do not leave the comment section blank, show what you checked and what you did. Mail these sheets to the avenues and it gives the address. Make sure you follow these guidelines and everyone will be happy and you'll get your pay on time.
Thank you. Based on the investigation, the preliminary investigation that you conducted, that Sergeant Weeks conducted and that he briefed you on?
Yes.
Did Deputy Skowronski follow the directions on that memo for that off-duty job?
No, not the directions on that memo.
When the Internal Affairs investigation was concluded and the findings were conduct unbecoming, neglect of duty, duty to read, understand, and comply with orders, and two attempts of violation of law, can you tell the board why you recommended a termination at the conclusion of the investigation?
Yes, looking at that and the policy violations before, it just seemed to be a pattern of not wanting to do what the supervisors had asked of him. And supervisor feedback from Sergeant Weeks was that he did not feel that he was being truthfully told what had transpired in the beginning of this investigation. So it appeared to us that it was a sort of a kind of tried to hide the true facts of him. And that's given the troubling fact that the Internal Affairs investigation also felt that he tried to get paid without working the detail, just added to that decision.
The board already has Exhibit 3, which is your recommendation for termination. Would you just refer to page 2, part of the decision that you made to recommend termination was based on his prior misconduct. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Would you review for the board that the prior misconduct that you stated in that memo that you used as part of your recommendation decision?
In reviewing the scheduled penalties, the following had occurred in the previous 36 months, which could be reviewed. There was an AWOL for a written warning, professional image, written warning, conduct unbecoming an off-duty, a written warning, professional image, an 8-hour suspension, and then evidence handling, 8-hour suspension.
Once you recommended the termination, can you tell us what happened next once you sent the paperwork up to the major?
I sent the paperwork up, and it was it's reviewed each step by the major, the chief, and the sheriff, and then the final outcome comes back, and the termination was upheld.
And so the major, the chief deputy, and the sheriff all concurred with your recommendation for termination?
That's correct.
Are you aware of whether Mr. Skowronski filed an appeal?
Yes.
An informal appeal?
I'm not aware of an informal appeal.
At this, around the same time that this investigation occurred, did Mr. Skowronski violate another policy that you're aware of?
The only other one I had a dealing with was the last thing in his file, which was the evidence in the sale.
All right, on April 3rd, a disciplinary action recommendation was made for the recovered property evidentiary material violation of policy. Is that what you're referring to?
Yes.
Can you tell us how you found out about that misconduct of Mr. Skowronski's?
Sorry, let me interrupt you. Is that part of the basis for the termination in this case?
Yes, sir. In that the multiple violations were a determining factor in why the termination was recommended.
So the violation that you're about, that Captain Hawkins about to talk about, was occurred before the termination and was part of the basis for the decision to terminate?
Yes.
Okay.
I got a call from the juvenile court about some reports that needed work, and that they looked at the charges and that things were missing, and the one that was brought up was this particular case, and after reading it, I looked and I didn't see the evidence vouchered anywhere. So I read the report and I didn't see it, so I signed it back to the supervisor. I said, could you find out where this marijuana is? It looks like we took it, but it's not in the report, and evidence didn't seem to have it. After that review, they found, Sergeant Weeks looked into it. It was it was collected, but it was put in the trunk and forgotten about, so he had to voucher the evidence at a later date, put the evidence away. He was disciplined for that procedural issue.
Witness to
can identify this document.
Yes, that's good to be the disciplinary action recommendation for that particular. So.
For the incident that we didn't discuss?
Yes, for the evidence.
And what is that mark?
Exhibit 8.
You wish to tender on FCA at this time?
Yes.
Any objections? All right, FCA will be admitted at this time.
For the board, sir.
Conclusion of this investigation for the evidence that wasn't turned in, Mr. Skowronski was recommended for an 8-hour suspension. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And you concurred with that?
Yes.
And the major, the chief, and the sheriff concurred with that also. Is that correct?
That's correct.
I have no further questions.
Thank you. Suzanne.
Okay, Mom, you said you spoke with Sergeant Weeks in regards to the avenue?
Yes.
What was the gist of that conversation?
Just the conversation was what happened in Weeks' response was, I know something happened. I know he didn't go there. I don't think I got the full story. And judging from the first memo, the second memo, there was additional facts brought to light, and Weeks didn't feel that he got all the information.
Were you aware at the time that I was asked for a statement what I was doing?
Was I around where?
Were you aware of what I was doing, the duties I was performing at the time I was asked for a statement by Sergeant Weeks?
I was aware that you had made a late arrest. That's what you're speaking of.
No, when Sergeant Weeks asked me for a statement, on the day he asked me for a statement, were you aware of the duties I was performing at that time?
No.
In regards to the evidence, did you speak to Sergeant Weeks or Lieutenant Fisher about that as well?
Yes.
And what was the gist of that close conversation?
The gist in everything I got out of the investigation was that you took it in, you vouched it, you had. Just had not turned it in, put it away, and forgot about it.
Were you aware of a conversation I had with Lieutenant Fisher regarding that incident?
Unless it was in the packet, I'm not aware of that conversation.
And who recommended this the 8-hour?
Who that came from, Sergeant Weeks.
Did you speak to me directly regarding either of the issues, the incidents?
No.
Did you speak to me prior to recommending termination?
No.
Did you not see the need for it?
No. I was going off the internal affairs investigation, which is my job is to review that and see what is founded and not founded and make the recommendation there.
Okay, so you don't think it's maybe important to speak to the person whose career we're about to end?
I would think that person would take it upon themselves to not put themselves in that type of situation where their career could be in jeopardy in that type of situation.
So you never spoke to me, and so you never, did you ever ask Sergeant Weeks about me?
I did.
And what did he say?
And what capacity?
In general.
In general? He said you can go do your job. And when asked if he wished that he'd stayed around after this, it was absolutely not.
The evidence
handling incident. That was after the Avenues, correct?
It was completed prior to the Avenues case.
Right. And yet it is part of the reason for termination. An incident that happened prior, after the incident that I was fired for. Is that correct?
In saying that it was done prior to that, that it happened, the actual incident happened after the Avenues. The Avenues incident was not completely investigated until afterwards. So, that's correct. That's not a sole deciding factor.
But it was part of the factor.
It was part of the factors.
Were you aware of the duties I was performing that day?
Such as your patrol duties or something?
Or what I was
doing? I got nothing.
Have you ever forgotten to do something during the course of the patrol period or anything?
I think people have, yes.
Do you know the specifics of any of the previous disciplines or did you
I read through them all.
You read all the specifics?
Yes.
Okay, so you didn't just browse through them and see what just
I read through them.
And you don't think any of them had mitigating circumstances?
Well, I think you can find mitigating circumstances if it's your benefit in all of them.
Sure.
I'm sure they all do. The question is, do you work through that or are you constantly looking for mitigating circumstances?
Right. Since you read through them all, do you specifically remember one conduct unbecoming in which a gentleman complained to Sergeant Chilton?
I'd have to look the file again.
Because in that memo that Sergeant Tilton wrote, there is a comment about the gentleman being rude with him on the telephone.
Okay.
And yet he continued to write, as per policy, continued to write the complaint.
Right.
So that's not a mitigating circumstances, whether it behooves me or not.
Right, and I deal with that every day. I take complaints all the time. People are rude with me on the phone. However, I'm not rude to them. It comes with just what we do.
And you've never been rude to anybody?
I'm sure that I have.
Okay. Have you cursed around people?
I'm sure I have.
That's all.
Can you redirect?
Yes, sir.
In Exhibit 8, it's already been tendered. Would you tell the board what date that disciplinary action recommendation for the evidence and recovered property was done?
The date it was prepared is 4/3/13.
Okay, so on April the 3rd, that disciplinary action recommendation was forwarded through the chain of command for the evidence issue?
Correct. I actually saw it and signed off on it on the 14th.
Thank you. In Exhibit 3, which is one of the things in there, is your memo to recommend Mr. Skowronski's termination. Would you tell the board what date that you wrote that memo and recommend termination?
April 24th.
Which is after April the 3rd when this disciplinary action recommendation was submitted for the marijuana?
Correct.
So would it be correct to say that during the internal affairs investigation, this evidence violation came to light and that you did know about it prior to writing the termination recommendation letter?
That is correct, yes, the timeline.
So even though it physically happened after the date at the Avenue, it was concluded prior to the investigation into the Avenues?
Yes, that was concluded rather quickly.
I have no further questions.
Can you recross this? Would have any questions?
Yes, sir, I have a couple. Going back to Exhibit 8, the marijuana in the trunk, what is department procedure when an arrest has been made and you take evidence? Is it common for one deputy to take possession of the evidence, or is it under dual control? What's policy when?
It's common if it's your charges, and again, this can be flexible if the deputy has a lot of things going on. But the deputy takes control of the charges and the marijuana, They'll package it, voucher it, and take the evidence usually at the ending of their shift. Sometimes if they can't get it evidence, they'll do it the very, very next day. Usually let their supervisor know. But it's procedure is turned into shift at the end of your shift.
Captain, I just have one more question. I want to make sure I understand. The evidence was taken possession of on March 21st, and it stayed in the trunk until March 30th. Is that right? 9 days?
The day, it was the day that the Sergeant Weeks asked him about it, so I believe that's correct.
So Mr. Skowronski rode around for 9 days with marijuana in his trunk?
Yes. They have the ability to, anyone above me has the ability to knock it down and make it higher, a higher grade.
A little higher than that for the sheriff.
Sir?
A little higher than that for the sheriff.
Right.
This was the sign, is they all know what they're signing?
Yes.
Let me ask one more question. Has he had all this post-training since he's been on my way back to the police officer?
Yes, sir.
If that's the same thing, all those things followed up in your training, post-training,
yes, and in our insertion.
Yes, sir.
He was issued a manual from the Sheriff's Department with all these punishments and results and rules and all that.
Yes.
Is that the question you were asking?
Yes, that all of these right here is.
Correct, yes.
So I said he shouldn't have known all about that, or about punishment for this and punishment for that, so.
Yes, sir.
He should have been aware of that, right?
Yes, sir.
So that's kind of like if you're chewing gum in church, your mom's going to look at you.
Yes, sir.
He should have known better. Oh, thank you.
I don't have any questions.
Okay. All right. May this witness be excused. All right. Thank you. Call your next witness.
You can wait.
You're doing a good job up at Super City, aren't you? Up at Super City.
Thank you.
I see you quite often.
Light duty, but my normal assignment is AWOCH South. I'm the sergeant over the patrol unit this time. We're doing that time. We answer calls for service.
Sergeant Weeks, did you supervise Mr. Skowronski when you worked here in the sheriff's office?
I did.
were you involved in two incidents of misconduct by Mr. Skowronski, one involving leaving marijuana in his trunk for 9 days, and one where he turned in a timesheet at the Avenues that nobody saw him working?
I was involved in.
Would you, let's start with the marijuana evidence issue. Would you just describe for the board your involvement, your direct involvement with that?
The two instances that they're describing kind of went hand in hand with each other. The marijuana was secured by Skowronski, and then phone call came up asking where the marijuana was, and I spoke with Skowronski about it, and he checked his trunk, and it was in there. Just kind of a real quick incident that he took care of. As soon as he discovered it was still in his trunk, he dropped into evidence that day. But we have a policy that you have to drop your evidence prior to leaving your shift.
And let me ask you a question. How is it a common mistake for officers to make in your experience to forget to turn in evidence?
It is common for the subject of evidence, but it is not common for drugs to not be turned in. Sometimes people have licenses or whatever that they forget to turn in when they leave shift, but narcotics and misdemeanor drugs is not common.
So property, sometimes a driver's license or something.
In
your experience, it's not common for deputies to forget to turn in vital evidence like narcotics or drugs, illegal evidence.
Yeah.
In the investigation into Mr. Skowronski's work at the Avenue, would you tell the board your direct involvement in that investigation?
Lieutenant Fisher directed me to get a written statement from Skowronski about a shift, an off-duty shift at the Avenues. Wasn't really put into the loop other than Skowronski worked for me. I was asked to get the statement. I retrieved the statement from Skowronski and then sent it back up the chain. At that point in time, Lieutenant Fisher, I believe, went on vacation and left. So Captain Hoffman redirected me to get another statement from Skowronski, more entailed. I sent Skowronski a list of questions that he needed to answer inside of his statement. Told Skowronski that obviously something's going on with his off-duty employer. He needed to figure out what it was. And then once the statement was given back to me, I went and spoke with the Avenues and followed up on the statement itself. I spoke with, I think it was Mr. Durden. I spoke with someone else on the phone at first, and then I physically went over and made contact with Mr. Durden and spoke with him about the issue, and then came back and documented the facts in which I found out, and then forwarded it up the chain of command from there. I don't know how much further after that. I was also called into internal affairs to restate my involvement in it. That was it.
What did Mr. Skowronski say, and what was his attitude when you directed him to go find out what was going on at the Avenue about his timesheet?
It was kind of like he presented it as it was a clerical error, and that it was no big deal, and he would take care of it. And then there was some type of, you know, conversation about that this was, you know, BS, and, you know, up where I came from, York, they wouldn't even have dealt with this. You know, initially, that's how I dealt with it. It was just kind of, okay, someone's complaining about how you handled yourself off duty, and then as we got further and further along, you know, the facts started showing up, you know, that not something might have gone differently than it should have gone. So.
What made you change your mind from that it might be a clerical error to that there might be some serious policy violations?
I think that what kind of changed my opinion in it was when the first time that I spoke with Skowronski, I said, hey, look, this guy's got some issues with how you handle yourself. You know, that's a, most of the time our part-time jobs are either officers of business, or they're, you know, organized through someone else, and you just come in and work them. And I was like, well, you know, you need to go over there and talk to the guy, find out what's wrong. Well, when I went back and spoke with Mr. Durden later on, he had said that Skowronski had taken his pay sheet that he had presented before. This is all like days and days after the event happened. And then didn't replace it with anything. And, you know, in law enforcement, you know, we don't make a lot of money. So, you know, granted, if I was an error dropping a timesheet, it was wrong, but I worked an hour and a half, I want my money for my hour and a half that I worked. And with the fact that he never did drop off a factual timesheet to get paid for the time that he was there, That's kind of when I was like, well, you know, maybe there's some meat to this. So.
So as far as you know, he never turned in a timesheet for the time that he says he was there and worked?
The day that I spoke with Mr. Durden, he had not turned in a timesheet. I don't know what happened past that point. This was, you know, probably 2 weeks after the event that happened, the shift, that Friday night shift.
Did you have a discussion with your lieutenant and your captain about what you believe the recommendation should be for Mr. Skowronski based on the two policy violations we discussed and based on your knowledge of prior policy violations?
I did. The 8-hour suspension that he received for the evidence was my recommendation, and it stuck all the way up and back down. And I believe for the infraction with the avenues, I asked for a time suspension, time off. I don't remember exactly how many hours I'd asked for. You know, that goes out of our control, and it went up to internal affairs, and then, you know, they continued on with the investigation that I started from there.
Based on the outcome of the internal affairs investigation, and your direct knowledge of other policy violations that Mr. Skowronski had done, did you agree with the termination recommendation by Captain Hall?
From everything that was given and presented, and then finding out the other information that I didn't know, you know, after my investigation stopped till they completed their investigation, yes, I do. It was appropriate.
And
you were Mr. Skowronski's direct supervisor, is that correct?
That's correct.
And how long have you been Mr. Skowronski's supervisor, either this time or in previous times also?
I'd say maybe 6-8 months over the course of our time together, because they move us around a lot.
And how long have you been a sergeant in uniform patrol supervisor?
This will be my 6th year as a sergeant.
I have no further questions.
Sergeant Wings.
How you doing?
Good.
Have you ever known him to lie to you?
He's not lied to me.
Any mistake that I've ever made? Any policy violations that have been brought to my attention, have I not admitted to them freely?
He's always been, if he made a mistake, he would own up to it, yes.
And I have accepted the consequences of those mistakes.
That is correct.
Even if I don't agree with them, I may complain about them, but I accept them.
That is correct.
In your opinion, was I a good officer?
When we elaborate on that question, we categorize, you know, deputies. You know, we have deputies that are traffic people, we have deputies that are good report takers, deputies that are good talkers. And being a supervisor, my job is to try to involve them correctly in what they do. Skowronski was a deputy that when things got real critical, that you could depend on him to do what he was required to do. It was that time of day.
Was there any aspect of police work as far as patrol that I could not do?
No.
And could do properly?
Yes.
You basically just answered the other question about if there was any doubt in a serious situation, if I would be there for you.
No, it was that was ingrained, you know, in him from where he came from. That was.
Can you say that of every other person you've worked with in this department?
No.
Other employees in this department have had serious infractions, more serious than mine. You know that they retain their employment?
Sir, I'd object to that with relevance to what we're addressing here today.
Yeah, first of all, I'm not sure he knows what you're talking about, but if it doesn't relate
there is an incident that is common knowledge throughout the department that the person was not terminated, demoted, or anything. That's all I was referring to. Okay. And I have the disciplinary record here that I'll show later.
Does it involve similar allegations to what
it shows serious allegations that should have been more severe than the repercussions that weren't.
Sir, I would ask that the relevance of when it occurred. We've had a change in administration and things that happened prior to our current sheriff. I don't think have any relevance to decisions that he has made since January the 1st.
I think it shows a pattern of what the deputies have come to expect. And even with a new change, I do have a disciplinary record after the new administration.
Here's what I'm going to do. This hearing is pretty informal, and we're not, whatever the court of law may do, we're a little more open than that. So what I'm going to do is allow you to ask, point out whatever you want to, but to the extent it's discriminatory towards him, I think it would be relevant. So I'm going to allow it. allow him to ask that question, and then if you want to point out the change in administration, you're free to do that.
Are you aware of former Lieutenant Maloney's actions?
Yes.
And what proceeded from that? Yes. Did he retain his job?
He did.
Was he demoted? The actions that he did, some which were a violation of law, he was not demoted, and he was not fired. Is that correct?
As far as I know, again, I had no direct involvement with the situation.
I know from your opinion, in your opinion, pretty much the entire department is aware of the situation that happened.
Yeah, it was in the news.
Did at any time did you recommend termination?
I did not.
You had a conversation with Captain Hoffman at some point about the incident with the Adams?
Yes, we talked a few times about it.
And during any of those conversations, did you tell him that you'd like to see me gone?
I did not.
How many pages is the policy manual?
Say it's well 2,000 or so.
2,000 or so. Do you know every single policy that's in there?
I do not.
Would it be safe to assume that most deputies do not know the entire policy?
I would say so.
That's correct. You remember what I was doing on a day in question that the arrest was effected that contained the marijuana?
Somebody asked this earlier and I got confused about it. I want to say it was a juvenile at Pine Ridge where we had domestic charges and marijuana charges. I want to say that's what it was.
Correct. Do you recall that I had to go to RYDC?
Yes.
Do you recall what my afternoon assignment was that day?
Do not.
I had the box that day. The box is, we call it the bubble, it's the front office of the precinct where you go in. Anybody can walk in, get the reports, they call in, get the reports. It winds up being busy. So after I got back from RYDC, I finished processing that. I was also doing four other reports that day for being in the bubble. Do you recall asking me for the statement regarding the amnesty the same day?
I don't remember when I asked you for the statement.
Do you remember telling me that you needed this ASAP?
That's probably what came up.
In regards to the marijuana, do you recall what I had the marijuana in?
I did not.
Do you recall a conversation we had about marijuana, about me not liking the smell?
Yeah, I remember that conversation.
And that I put it in a clear box so I don't smell it.
I don't remember that. Okay.
After I dropped the ovens, did you not go back and double check it?
I did.
And was everything there that you recall?
It was.
At any time during that day, do you remember asking me or reminding me about dropping the marijuana?
I did not.
In regards to my last quarterly review that you did, this is my own comment.
All right, if you would show it to
Show it to the sergeant.
Is this mine to look through?
Yes. Do you recognize that, sir?
I do.
Is that the evaluation you gave me, the last one?
It appears to be. I would not be able to say that unless it came out of our record department, but it appears to be.
On the bottom there, in the comments section, employee comments, what did I write?
Well, before you do that, do you want to tender at this time?
Yes.
Any objection?
No.
All right, submitted without objection. Is that marked WS1?
Yes.
All right, go ahead.
Says any issues and mistakes that I had or made, I had omitted freely and strive not to have them reoccur.
The conversation we had after giving that back to you, what was your comment to him? You remember?
I don't.
Was it along the lines of that you agreed and signed up on it?
The way that this works is that we fill it out based upon, we don't even do these anymore, but we fill this out based upon the quarter that the employees work. The score is given, and the deputies are allowed to assign comments to them for their own purposes. Our conversation specifically, not that just have sometimes 13 or so of these to do, so it's not really a conversation.
But bringing it again now, in your opinion, is that pretty much how I do it?
Yeah, I mean, if you're called, you admit to your infractions. I said that, stated that earlier.
Yes, sir.
The marijuana that you found, although when Mr. Skowronski asked you about it, you checked it to make sure that it was submitted correctly and all that, but that was 9 days later after it had not been turned in when it was discovered that you double checked it and determined that it had now been turned in. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. I actually called an evidence tech in and had it open the evidence locker. Reviewed it, and it was the correct marijuana.
The policy, the policy's actually 1,096 pages, which is very large. And in your experience as a sergeant supervising a dozen deputies or more, although they're not familiar with all almost 1,100 pages, they tend to be very familiar with the parts that they do on a daily basis or on a regular basis. Would you agree with that?
I would. The policy is a guideline for us to, have productive people working for us. Anybody that works in this business knows that, we use the law book, common sense. Some people say your heart, and then we use the policy manual to kind of guide our directions. It doesn't say in the policy manual that you're supposed to have integrity and good character, but that's where we fall back on your heart and your mind and making the right decision when it's easy to make the wrong decision is what we strive for. That's not in the policy manual either. So we do our best to try to push people in the direction we go. The policy manual was designed that if we're walking a straight line and someone steps off the straight line, the policy manual is designed to push them back on that line. And everybody strays, but we use that to push people in the direction we want to go to have productive officers for the county.
So would you say that
a deputy who works part-time jobs on a regular basis, in your experience, would know the basic policy about what they're required to do for part-time jobs?
I would.
They may not know some of the other parts that they don't deal with on a regular basis, but the things that they do on a as part of their regular duties, they would be familiar with.
That is correct. Specifically in Skowronski's case, that you're required to notify that you're out. If you guys ever have an opportunity to look on our computer system, it's called a Signal 90, or whatever the new signals are. Everybody that's out, you know their location. And it's designed as a safety mechanism. If Skowronski was to get in a fight or a foot chase to avenues, and you know, when we key up on a radio, it'll say our name or our badge number or something to the effect. So we're always trained, the first thing we do is give out our location, because that's all we can say, at least somebody knows to come to that location. Well, the purpose of it is to say, hey, you know, I'm working at the avenues, my name's Skowronski. So if he keys up and all you hear is a shot come out, everybody and their brother knows we're going to the avenues because that's where he called out at. It's a safety policy. That's why it's installed there.
So Deputy Skowronski, you should have been aware of this policy since he's been working that part-time job for over a year.
No further.
Avery Cross.
Yes. As far as speaking with me throughout this time, did we ever have a conversation about what was going on at personal life or anything like that that may be distracting him?
I've had some conversations with Skowronski about his personal life on and off through his time here. I knew there was some, at least specifically, there was an issue about he was having to pay child support for an 18-year-old child, and he didn't have the money to go back to court to get the document changed to where he was released from the child support. I believe that's
right. Do you remember me telling him that that was going to be stopping? I would get a $400 basically pay raise for myself.
So yeah, I mean that was, I remember that part of the conversation.
And that money would not be pretty much an issue for me much longer.
You know, I can't actually recall. I remember the conversation. I remember you going, well, I got to spend $400 to stop having to pay $400 or something like that.
Questions about the board?
Okay. Sergeant Weeks, back to the time sheet. Who brought the issue with the time sheet for duties that were supposed to be performed at you? Who brought that issue to Mr. Skowronski?
The way I was explained it, I'll give you the whole story. That way, I don't know if anybody said it yet. The county requires businesses to pay a fuel allowance to use our vehicles. So, like, if you hired me to do a job in full uniform in a county vehicle, you'd have to cut a check to the county, and it's like $5 or $10. I don't remember exactly how much it is to the county, separate of what you paid me for the use of the fuel for the vehicles. The avenues had the security guards were directed to tell the admin staff of the avenues if they didn't see the patrol vehicle working the security job, so they could stop the $5 or $10 check that they submit separately of the payment to the deputy. So when the security guards told the admin personnel that they didn't see a deputy there that night, they contacted our department, and then it worked its way down to me, is how it was. That was the gist of how the complaint came down. So that's what began everything.
But again, my question was, who actually brought it to the attention of Mr. Skowronski?
I did. Okay. Yeah, I was asked to get a statement from him about his off-duty job that night from Lieutenant Fisher. And then he gave me the statement, and then I sent it back up to Lieutenant Fisher. Because I wasn't, when we get complaints for investigations, like they'll assign a sergeant, I wasn't initially assigned to deal with that complaint. It was above my pay grade initially.
Okay. That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
When you first approached Mr. Skowronski, did he tell you that he had submitted a timesheet for the time that he worked? When did you become aware that he didn't work?
It would have been after the interview with the admins.
After you went a long time?
Yeah, it was
2 weeks or so afterwards.
It was when he gave me an initial statement. I sent it up to chain of command. They asked me to ask specific questions and get a better statement. I got that better statement, then I drove to the avenues to interview. At that point in time, I was found out that there was the invoice was submitted, and that they're claiming he wasn't there for that duration of time, and that there was never a corrected timesheet submitted.
And that was several days, 2 weeks later?
Yes, sir.
After the incident? Are you aware that Mr. Skowronski went and met with Mr. Durden on the 20th?
Yes.
And was given his timesheet back?
Yes, sir.
You knew that when?
When I got
when
to.
You went, when you went to it, you yes, knew
sir.
That?
Yes, sir. That's when they told me he came and got his timesheet back.
And he hadn't submitted one, and that's when you became suspicious?
Yes, sir. When I asked, did he submit a corrected timesheet, and they said no. And that's when I was like, that's when I started kind of
looking back on everything that's been said, is there any point in this whole episode that Mr. Skowronski told you something that wasn't true? Now, I'm not asking you, did he leave stuff out that might have not been true, but is there anything he told you? Did he tell you the first time you talked with him that he worked that whole shift?
No, sir.
Did he tell you that he didn't work?
He told me he was late. He was late for the shift.
Did he tell you how many hours or minutes he did work?
No, sir.
As it turned out, it was 45 minutes is what we've been told here, that's all the time that he worked.
There was we researched and found his swipe time out in the avenues are like right across the street from our office. So there was the question as to, okay, well, if you swiped out this time, how come that's not when you started working that time? I've heard other things through the investigation, but I can't testify to that because that's just what I've heard, that he said he did, like went and let a dog out or whatever it may have been. I can't testify to that because I don't know that.
Well, did he ever tell you that he sat in the south end of the parking lot for 45 minutes and filled out a report?
Yes, sir. He did tell me that. Yes, sir.
I have nothing to ask.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. This witness may be excused. Getting pretty close to lunch. Is your next witness going to take some time?
I don't believe so. No, sir.
Yeah, unless you can do it in 5 minutes. I tell you what, why don't we just we'll take a break.
Yes,
come back at 1:15.
Yes, sir.
Okay. See everybody back at 1:15. We're at recess until then.
Yeah.
Yes, you're fine. The lady here, right?
Is the door going to be locked?
I know I had to come in and just observe. It feels good to just observe. Yes, I do.
Ms. Carson, I was looking so forward to that, getting to ask you questions. You are my favorite witnesses of all time.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Is that why you want to be a caller? She's one of your favorite witnesses?
No, we never have.
You came to observe?
Yes, I did. I like observing much easier than, but I did want to see because it, you know, you are new.
Good to see you.
And really, just this whole different. So I wanted to
do you ever say?
Observe,
well,
see, and
don't think that.
Yeah.
We like that.
Where does it go?
Let's go, man. We're going to be late.
Big screen the other night.
Sandra Bosch.
At the board meeting. So,
you can get a good medal today.
Well, I'm glad you're not a witness. I was worried if you.
No, no. I know he loves questioning me all the time. Good. Good to see you. Yeah. The one that takes some time, at least.
Let me go drop Brent off.
Awesome, man.
Weeks.
You want to meet me over there?
But he's got bubble duty. And I'll go over there.
What you on my duty for? What happened to it?
How are you?
I'm well, thank you very much.
Good to see you.
Thank you.